SpaceX breaks silence on Flight 3 anomaly after 3 months. James Webb Space Telescope's new discovery. Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started. Before we begin, a quick reminder. Some of our members have mentioned that they're not receiving notifications for our new uploads. To help resolve this, please take a moment to like this video, ensure the notification bell is turned on, and finally double check that you're subscribed to our community. Welcome back. Today, we have a crucial update from SpaceX about the Flight 3 anomaly and the upgrades for Flight 4. This is an official update, and I'll be covering all the details, so don't skip any part of this video. If you're a Starship fan, it's important to pay close attention. On March 14, 2024, SpaceX achieved a significant milestone as the Starship Super Heavy successfully lifted off from Starbase, Texas at 8:25 a.m. The launch marked a crucial step forward for the program, as all 33 Raptor engines on the Super Heavy booster roared to life and completed a full duration burn during ascent. This achievement was followed by a successful hot stage separation, making it the second time the Super Heavy booster, the world's most powerful launch vehicle, had accomplished this feat. As the Starship and Super Heavy separated, the 6 second stage Raptor engines sprang into action, powering the vehicle to its expected trajectory and becoming the first Starship to complete its full duration ascent burn. However, the mission was not without its challenges. During the boost back burn, which is designed to propel the Super Heavy booster towards its intended landing location, 13 of the vehicle's 33 Raptor engines were commanded to start up. While all 13 engines ran successfully initially, 6 engines shut down prematurely, triggering a benign early boost back shutdown. Despite this setback, the Super Heavy booster continued its descent and attempted its landing burn, which commands the same 13 engines used during boost back to slow down the rocket before a soft touchdown in the water. However, the 6 engines that shut down early in the boost back burn were disabled from attempting the landing burn startup, leaving only 7 engines to try and start up, with only 2 successfully reaching main stage ignition. The booster experienced lower than expected landing burn thrust, and contact was lost at approximately 462 meters in altitude over the Gulf of Mexico, just under 7 minutes into the mission. An investigation into the early boost back burn shutdown revealed that the most likely root cause was continued filter blockage in the liquid oxygen supply to the engines, leading to a loss of inlet pressure in the engine oxygen turbopumps. To address this issue, SpaceX implemented hardware changes ahead of Flight 3, which allowed the booster to progress to its first ever landing burn attempt. Furthermore, Super Heavy boosters for Flight 4 and beyond will receive additional hardware inside oxygen tanks to further improve propellant filtration capabilities. In addition to the challenges faced by the Super Heavy booster, the Starship also experienced some issues during its coast phase. The vehicle accomplished several of the flight test's additional objectives, including the first ever test of its payload door in space and a successful propellant transfer demonstration. However, several minutes after entering its coast phase, the Starship began losing the ability to control its attitude, causing it to deviate from its planned trajectory. Despite this, the vehicle continued flying its nominal trajectory, but the loss of attitude control resulted in an automatic command to skip its planned on-orbit relight of a single Raptor engine. The Starship went on to experience its first ever re-entry from space, providing valuable data on heating and vehicle control during hypersonic re-entry. However, the lack of attitude control resulted in an off-nominal entry, with the ship experiencing much larger than anticipated heating on both protected and unprotected areas. High-definition live views of entry and a considerable amount of telemetry were successfully transmitted in real time by Starlink terminals operating on Starship. The flight test's conclusion came when telemetry was lost at approximately 65 kilometers in altitude, roughly 49 minutes into the mission. The investigation into the unplanned roll revealed that the most likely root cause was clogging of the valves responsible for roll control. To address this issue, SpaceX has added additional roll control thrusters on upcoming Starships to improve attitude control redundancy and upgraded hardware for improved resilience to blockage. Following the flight test, SpaceX led the investigation efforts with oversight from the FAA and participation from NASA and the NTSB. The investigation found that neither vehicle's automated flight safety system was triggered, and no vehicle debris impacted outside of predefined hazard areas. Pending FAA finding of no public safety impact, a license modification for the next flight can be issued without formal closure of the mishap investigation. The lessons learned from the third flight of Starship will be crucial in the development of future missions. Upgrades derived from the flight test will debut on the next launch from Starbase on Flight 4, as the focus shifts from achieving orbit to demonstrating the ability to return and reuse Starship and Super Heavy. The team has incorporated numerous hardware and software improvements, including operational changes such as the jettison of the Super Heavy's hot stage adapter following boost back to reduced booster mass for the final phase of flight. The third flight of Starship provided a glimpse into a rapidly reusable future, and the team is continuing to rapidly develop Starship, putting flight hardware in a flight environment to learn as quickly as possible. The ultimate goal is to build a fully reusable transportation system designed to carry crew and cargo to Earth orbit, the Moon, Mars, and beyond. That's all about SpaceX's official update. If you want to read this complete info, I will attach a direct link to the website in the description box. Just a quick update, I have done a detailed video on upcoming Starliner launch. You know, NASA and Boeing are launching it without fixing the helium leak. Yes, you heard it right. As I told you at the beginning, since we are facing some issues with YouTube's recommendation system, I think most of you may have missed that video. So make sure to watch that video after this. I will put the link either in the comment box or at the top right corner. Astronomers have made a historic breakthrough using the James Webb Space Telescope, JWST, uncovering three of the universe's earliest galaxies in their formative stages, dating back to a mere 400 to 600 million years after the Big Bang. These ancient galaxies, resembling fuzzy red smudges, are actively forming and feeding on nearby helium and hydrogen. Over millions of years, these elements will sustain and shape these galaxies into the familiar elliptical and spiral structures we observe across the cosmos. According to study lead author Kasper Elm Heinz, an astrophysicist at the Cosmic Dawn Center, Dawn in Denmark, these are the first direct images of galaxy formation that we've ever seen. While James Webb has previously shown us early galaxies at later stages of evolution, here we witness their very birth, and thus the construction of the first star systems in the universe. The universe underwent a period of darkness around 400,000 years after the Big Bang, when space cooled enough for neutral hydrogen atoms to form, creating an opaque primordial fog. This fog lifted about 1 billion years after the Big Bang, when light from the first generation of stars flooded the universe. Recent research has revealed that dwarf galaxies formed during the first few hundred million years of the universe played a crucial role in driving this fog-relieving process. Study co-author Derek Watson notes, "This is the process that we see the beginning of in our observations. These galaxies are like sparkling islands in a sea of otherwise neutral, opaque gas." Heinz adds, "We're witnessing the birth of the first star systems in the universe." The JWST's powerful infrared eye has captured how light from the three observed galaxies was absorbed by large, dense reservoirs of neutral hydrogen gas around them, revealing gas gathering into and feeding the galaxies themselves. The abundance of gas in the scene is so great that the galaxies haven't yet given birth to their first stars. The formation of stars requires primordial gas to coalesce into extremely dense pockets, which then sparks the creation of stellar bodies. This process would have taken millions of years in these galaxies. Astronomers still grapple with understanding how gas is distributed between the centers of galaxies, housing supermassive black holes and their outskirts. Future observations may solve this puzzle and reveal if these galaxies' gas reservoirs are entirely composed of primordial hydrogen or already contain heavier elements. Study co-author Gabriel Brammer of Dawn emphasizes, "It is a process that we'll investigate further until hopefully we are able to fit even more pieces of the puzzle together." He notes that this discovery demonstrates that JWST is exceeding its primary mission goals. Images and data of these distant galaxies were impossible to obtain before Webb. Plus, we had a good sense of what we were going to find when we first glimpsed the data. We were almost making discoveries by eye. This discovery marks a significant milestone in our understanding of the universe's early stages, and the JWST's capabilities are paving the way for further exploration and revelation. Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.